You make beautiful Good morning. Many of us woke up this morning knowing that today is going to be really good. So I hope everybody put their worship shoes on this morning. Let's all stand and praise God.
Yeah, amen.
Praise team another hand clap. They're awesome, aren't they? You can be seated this morning. How's everyone doing? Good. I'm glad you're here this morning. I want to welcome you to Spirit of Truth. First thing I always want to do is welcome anyone that's here for the first time. We don't embarrass you, but we do want to welcome you to what we voted as the best church in Ohio. So just raise your hand if it's your first time, and Pastor Kathy will give you a little card if you want to fill it out, and then after the service in the lobby, we have a little gift for you. So just keep your hand raised, and she'll be around. We also like to open the, when we start the service, as you guys, we know this, give you a chance to share testimonies or something good that happened to you this week, or that you could use to encourage someone else. So who'd like to go first?
Their Tuesday, the bad weather. I've never been in a whiteout at my age. Kind of scary. You need to be prayed up before it happens. Ended up in the ditch, so I thank the Lord that he watched over me and kept me safe. And you know, I know you guys don't know too much about me, but I went to Church of God for years, and it closed. So I'm like, well, where am I going to go? I went to different churches. My daughter started coming here, so her and her two children and friends. So I just want to thank you all for being nice. Especially the pastor and his wife.
Amen. So glad to have you here. As you say, we are the best church in Ohio. So, I mean, we stacked the deck a little bit because we voted, but I think it's still true. Who else wants to go next? All right, thanks, Tara.
I found a job.
That's awesome. I saw that on Facebook. That's congratulations. Damon, we're waiting.
Oh, the other day, Wednesday, my blood pressure was 161 over 181, pulse 98, and I started crying. Went to bed, thought I was going to die, and I prayed real deep, and I got up next morning. I recorded my blood pressure, and it's better than it ever has been for a while. And I got full time now. I got to go to second shift, but I got seniority, so hopefully, God willing, I'll be back to first shift before spring or summer because I'm very active and I need to lose some of this weight.
All right. We're happy for you, David. Thank you. We've been missing that. All right. Who else? Ann?
I actually went to Triple Crown yesterday with one of my sisters, and it was her daughter's birthday, basically. And I was up on the, I guess it's considered the wipeout thing where it spins around. And there was this guy up there reading a Christian book, and we got to talking about the book. And then we got on the subject of church. He hadn't had a church in Columbus because he had just moved there. So I suggested and pulled up the Ustream, showed him some stuff on there, and he's going to come see you guys in Columbus now.
Awesome. That is awesome. All right. Appreciate it, man. Did you tell me you're the best church in Ohio? Did you?
Okay.
All right. Just want to make sure. You're all going to be very aware of that. All right. This side of the room has been very quiet, the sanctuary, so over here. Millie, you doing better? We've been praying for you.
I had over 100 people that come in to pray for me. And I'm so glad you said that.
Amen.
Appreciate that. Everyone praying for her. Okay, anyone else? Sherry?
You finally approved my Social Security.
Well, hey, that's a good thing. All right. Congratulations on that. All right, last one. Anyone who's, see anyone in the back? Maybe if you have your hand raised, I can't see all the way back there. No? Okay. Then just a couple then quick testimonies. So, yeah, Tuesday, we know our bodybuilding class at 7. We were grateful for those of us that drove here because the weather was awful and it was a smaller group, but so we understand that some couldn't make it. But you missed a good one. It was around the types of offense, three different types of offense, and how you handle it if you get offended. How many have been offended? All right. How many have offended someone else? All right. So I was talking about how you, regardless if we're the one, right, Linda, that did the offending or were offended, we need to go to the person one-on-one. It was weird. The Bible didn't say anything about posting about it on Facebook or social media. Maybe they didn't. I don't know. Maybe whatever they had it, but he didn't mention to do that. But he did tell us what we need to do. And regardless, like I said, it's up to us either make it right one way or the other. So it was really good. So I don't know if maybe we'll rewatch that one because it was about the seven of us that enjoyed it. But I'm thankful too. I started sliding on the highway on the way here, and I think Haley, and I know some others did too. So again, 7 o'clock, I want to invite you out for our bodybuilding class. And then also wanted to mention Rooted. We have our Rooted class. So it'll be this Saturday here at 7. Starting on Sundays in February, I think starting February 1st, which that's a Monday, I think. So right around then, but we'll get the date. Rooted will be on the radio. Locally, WMUZ Sundays at 10 a.m. So just in time when you're getting ready for church or on your way here, be listening for the Rooted group. So more details on that exact date, but it'll be exciting, right? Part of our outreach ministry. So appreciate everyone that'll be involved in doing that. And then also the whole church, Spirit of Truth, will be back on TBN, actual services, not just the pastor's hosting. Our broadcasts, and that will be in February as well, Saturdays at 3 p.m. So another good time slot there too. So a lot happening. In a minute we'll be taking our outreach ministry offering, so appreciate anyone that can help us with that, because we're a lot of stuff going on new year, so we said a lot of new things were coming, so appreciate everyone that can help us there. Also just want to mention with our Sunday school, so children 5 and 5 and up, but I think last week I had mentioned, but we're getting them to learn Bible verses, small ones, and then if they can bring them back the next week and have it memorized, I think they get a little prize or recognized. So if you have a child that you're bringing that's in Sunday school, just help them throughout the week to remember to do that. I said last week when I was in Sunday school, I appreciated when my parents reminded me, so I wasn't trying to cram it in on the way here on Sunday mornings or Saturday nights. So make sure they bring their paper home with them, and then you help them with it throughout the week. So you'll be learning a new verse too. All right, and then we do have a nursery, of course, too, if you want to take advantage of those. So I think before we take television off, I'll do our drawing, but anything? I think we're good. All right, so you want to help me draw this morning, Mama? Doesn't she look pretty? Let's give her Pastor's wife a hand. That was sad, y'all. All the way in the back. I thought I took the back row. Jeff, we're glad you're here. Let me see if we have Jeff Leach. I'll come. Well, you need to meet me halfway. I can't walk the mile to the second to last row. A little gift for you. We're glad you're here. One of our greeters. Give another hand clap. Okay. All right. Well, if everyone can stand, Danielle, if you'll play some music, let's greet each other. If you can help us out with our outreach ministries, we can really appreciate it. Again, show yourself friendly this week. Also have some birthdays, so make sure you let Dara and Jesse Berberick know their birthdays are on Tuesday, so embarrass them. You're not already, let's stand and welcome back our praise team. Give them a hand clap.
I found a rock that I can stand on, though the water keeps on rising. I cling a little tighter to the promise of God's word. I will step a little higher. I will not be taken under. When the storm is over, I will stand on heaven's shore.
While walking through death's valley, I saw the storm clouds forming, but I didn't want to die there all alone. So I cried unto the Father amidst the raging water, and he picked me up.
sun rising. I'll cling a little tighter to the promise of God's word. I will step a little higher. I will not be taken under. When the storm is over, I will stand on heaven's shore. When the storm is over,
alive. in me, Jesus reigns. The curse of sin has been swept away. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. On a cross now I see a guiltless man crucified. That day, the stone that sealed it would be rolled away. Hallelujah. Since the battle has been won, since the Lamb has overcome, I will see.
My song goes on, hallelujah.
Jesus reigns. The curse of sin has been swept away. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. On a cross now I see a guiltless man crucified. Stone that sealed it would be rolled away. Hallelujah. Since the battle has been won, since the Lamb has overcome, I will sing my
see those Just bow your head for a moment, if you will, please. Let's just bow our heads. Father, your presence is so powerful in this room. You're ready to fix something in somebody's life. The Spirit of the Lord is speaking this morning, and if you're going through a struggling time, fighting a battle that's bigger than you are, I'd like for you to come to the front and just let everybody here that loves you pray and agree for blessings. If there's something that you're fighting, there's something struggling in your spirit, you want to fix it. You want to be able to celebrate as the praise team is celebrating. You want to be able to have the peace that passes understanding. Allow God to fix what's wrong. This is not religion. This is just relationship with the one that loves us the most. Praise team was talking yesterday, and it's not about singing a song as much as it is worshiping him. And when you worship God, there are those that watch you, and you'll lead them into worshiping as well. It's real this morning. Don't let the enemy rob you from the greatest victory and the greatest blessing of your life. You're in a safe place. You're in a healthy place, a place where everyone around you loves you and just wants God's very best for your life. Feel like someone is struggling and just needing that victory. No reason to wait any longer. Let's just open our spirit and let the Lord do for us what we can't do for ourselves. Can we come into agreement? Those of you in the room, maybe you're on top of the world. Everything's fine with you, but never be ashamed of wanting or needing him in your life. I'm already the first one here because I need him to do those things that I can't do, to fix what I've messed up, to put back together what I've broken. Would you point your hand this way in agreement? Father, we're thankful today for what you're already doing. God, you're the God that works from the inside out. You're the God that knows how to explain to us what we're feeling when we can't even explain it to ourselves. Our regrets, our hurts, questions, and fears. So today we speak peace because you're speaking peace. We speak victory because you're speaking victory. The long-awaited answers, the long-awaited, so long-hindered blessings and changes. Do for us today, Father, what only you can do. We trust you for that. The Spirit of the Lord says that he makes a way where there just seems like there's no way. How many times I've looked around and it didn't seem like there's any possibility. That's when God has to make a way. He creates a new way where there was no way before. Thank you, Father, because we allow you to take over. The battle is not ours now, the battle is yours. Nothing in your hand is dedicated to defeat, but always to victory. So we trust you for it, and we speak life. Lisa, like a prism, the light shines in one way and it comes out in multifaceted colors the other way. Not only for yourself, but for those that are heavy on your heart, situations bigger. More powerful than us, but nowhere near as powerful as God. Fix it. Finish it. In Jesus' name. Let everybody in agreement say, just right now, let the hand of the potter touch my clay. You've started proving yourself, Father, in new ways. You're going to finish it. You said there's times that the clay is marred while it's in the potter's hand. The wet clay is on the wheel spinning. The Father has to break it because something's wrong. And then he removes it. He breaks off what's going to destroy us and applies what will bring us back life. We yield our clay to the Master's hand, to the potter. You know what needs to be removed, and you know what needs we need to have added to our lives. Have your way, God. We trust you. Father, when words are not enough and words don't explain it, you read off the canvas of our soul our request, our petition, our need, our hurts, our disappointment, the unfaithfulness, the unfairnesses that have happened against us and through us and to us. Those things we've reached out to others. But today we ask you to change us, to fix us. You're the only one that can. To make a way where there just seems to be no way. Many are the plans of man, but it's the Lord that creates the victory and directs our path. And right now, the Lord has watched you as a domino moving, changing, desiring, hungry. Sometimes we come to the well and it seems like it's just empty, but the Lord said, today it springs forth within your soul. It's going in your behalf. It's washing from within and without. Not only for you, but everything and everyone around you. Because he loves you so much and you're willing to let it happen. Margie, it's those long, long, long battles that wear us down. It's when we're dealing with the others around us, warring for them. But the Lord is reminding you simply today that you've given them to him. Trust him, praise him, stand boldly before God faithful. That's the victory. And it will be established in Jesus' name. Thank you for your presence, Lord. Thank you for your presence, Lord. I'm going to say this morning something that's... Every one of us in this room have hit the wall. How many will agree? How many of you fell down, didn't mean to fall down, or you fell down, had it planned, whatever it was, it doesn't matter. You realize something about being in that place you thought was awesome until you fell. Then it wasn't awesome anymore. You had the rage, you had the discussion, you had the attack, you had the war. And you thought that, what if I can just vent my anger and if I can tell everybody else off and if I can do my own thing, it'll fix it. It doesn't do anything but make things worse. You can't fight spiritual battles with carnal words. Men use weapons, God uses words, and he is the word. The word that I need this morning is the same word that you need. You may have a different scenario going on in your life, but God knows what that is. My brother, I'm glad you're here today because God is digging real deep and he's pulling out some great blessings in your life. I'm honored that you're here. But so you don't know him. Well, I don't know him, but the one that made him is the one that made me, and that makes us brothers. How many of you recognize something is taking place? We had prayer of the staff before the service today, and the Lord was talking to us about the fact that he's digging way down deep, beyond the pain, beyond when it started, to heal those things that we don't fully even understand that causes our anger and our frustration, that causes the pain that keeps resurfacing over and over and over again. How many of you are ready for God to fix it once and for all and let him be glorified in every area? Can you lift your hands together and just say, Lord, you're the God of all authority and a God of all creation, and today we submit all of our needs and all of our fears and frustrations and threats into your hand. We need you and we trust you. We may not have been able to be as faithful in the past as we wish we had, but we can start right now. A brand new beginning to be faithful before you and obedient before you, to claim a covenant that can never fail because it's your covenant with us. We accept it. We believe for great things starting today in Jesus' name. Everybody in agreement, say with us, amen. Look at somebody and tell them everything is going to be all right. Amen. I think we need to give the praise team a nice hand for their gifts, their talents, their efforts, all that they've shared with us. Amen. We're so very, very blessed. Amen. A lot of work goes into it. There's many things that we don't even recognize at times to make possible. And it was mentioned a little bit earlier, we're preparing some new television broadcasting. We're preparing, the Rooted System is going to go into new radio programming. Kind of amazing. We got a call from TBN. They're rearranging all their schedules, invited us to come on in new time slots. And then within just a few hours, we got a call from a radio station. We didn't even ask them for time. How many know that God knows how to sometimes just sort of show you that he wants you to do something new and different? And by saying, well, radio's old hat. No, there's people that can listen to the radio at work when they won't let you watch TV. How many know people can do that driving in their car? And if you're watching TV driving in your car, I want to know when you're leaving because I want to leave after you leave. I've been driven off the road too many times by folks. Y'all still here? And so if you will, pray about it because we're believing that God's going to do tremendous things. And this is going to be a great year. And I'll go ahead and say it. This is going to be a year probably of the most amazing changes we've ever had in our life. Changes are going to happen this year that we don't like, and there's changes that we need to change because God has to do new things. How many know we're watching as death takes place in the last 2 or 3 months? Death has seemed like it's just bombarding in every family, in every area. And what you got to realize, God's taking his kids on home. Amen. I don't know if you know this or not, but heaven's a lot better than Fayette County. I know that shocks you, and some of you love the courthouse and Bloomingburg, but how many know heaven's a whole lot better than around here? You don't know how I know that because I'm around here. But I want you to hear this morning. I'm going to ask you to go to Scripture. I want to share some principles that sometimes when you're giving a word, the enemy fights really hard when it's what's needed. And there are so many attacks that have come against the body of Christ not to hear what the Lord is wanting us to hear. Anybody ready for your best year? I thought you said changes are coming. Yes, but I want my changes to glorify God. If I want the will of God, he's going to do his will, so I'm going to be blessed to be a part of his will. Trouble only comes when we're willing to have our own way and be stubborn if we don't get it. Any stubborn folks in the house? Just two. How many of you are steadfast? Same thing, just sanctified stubbornness. Amen. If you go with me to 2 Kings, the Old Covenant, I want to show you some things. This year, this week, the Lord has been repeating this in my spirit in so many different angles, and I want to give it to you because I said to the body of Christ a week or two ago here, anything that comes out of this pulpit is never to put you down, hinder you, hurt you, embarrass you, or force you into anything. Anytime we give a strong word, it's to warn you so you don't have to suffer. Is to keep you from going into a pit or going into something that's going to bring great harm later. We're here to help to divert those things and divert your footsteps onto a pathway that will bring blessing to you. I just want to bounce around this for a minute. I want to save several hours because we don't have that much time. We have to get to the restroom before the Presbyterians eat up all the food. Just teasing. 2 Kings 18 and 1. It came to pass in the third year of Hoshea, the son of Elah, the king of Israel, Hezekiah, the son of Ahaz, the king of Judah, began to reign. Somebody said, why did you say all that? It's history. There's a king that begins to reign in the land of praise and the land of Judah. 25 years old when he began to reign, he reigned for 29 years in Jerusalem. His mother's name was Abi, and she was a daughter of Zechariah. He did that which was right in the sight of the Lord. Would somebody say he did what was right? You know, there's times that when you're living in a heathen society, in a pagan society, when my father was preaching about pagans and heathen societies, I thought about somewhere over in the Middle East or somewhere, you know, in the dark regions of another country. I realize that we're talking about many times America now. I mean, anybody that is a God hater and tries to destroy God, that's a heathen spirit. Can I get one amen? So the Bible said he did what was right in the midst of that, and he did what was right in the eyes of the Lord, and he did because David, his forefather, had done those things that were right, and he removed all the high places. He broke down the images and cut down the groves. Now, we don't quite understand that, but in those days, when you were worshiping idols, you would get outside the town and get among the trees, and you'd set up idols, and you'd worship the idols. Take a piece of rock and carve it and make it into a god. I don't understand how anybody can take a piece of wood, carve it out into a bull head, and bow down to what you know was a tree before you had shaped it into a bull. But see, sometimes because we want to worship our way, we'll overlook the fact that we know it's not right. There's some things we want to believe. We know it's not right, but we choose to believe that. It doesn't make it right just because we choose to believe it. Am I right? So the Bible said he was willing to cut down all that idolatry, and then he did something that we don't talk about a lot. He broke in pieces the brazen serpent that Moses had made. For in those days, the children of Israel burned incense to it, and they had a special name for it. I want to explain this. The children of Israel are walking in rebellion against God as they're coming out of Egypt into the promised land. They got an attitude of rebellion. Anybody ever get one of those for a minute? And so God let snakes come around and begin to sting and bite and destroy them. They were just dropping dead. And God said to Moses, if you'll take a piece of brass and shape it into a serpent, put it up on a pole, everybody that looks at that serpent will live. Nobody will die. And the ones that were starting to die, the ones who were in trouble, when they looked upon the brazen serpent, they lived. So why did he do that? Because the Bible tells us it's a fore revelation of Jesus is our sacrifice, and he took our curse, hung on a pole, so that everybody that looks at him will live today. Not only now, but also forever. And the Bible said that when Moses created that, people that would have died did not die because they looked upon the brazen serpent. We talked last week or so about the rod that Moses threw on the ground. It became a serpent. It was not to destroy. His was to devour every other serpent, every other evil spirit, and to conquer it. You have to understand the Lord is our sacrifice. He is our brazen serpent. He is everything that we need. But the problem with it was the people of God, years and years later, were still offering sacrifices to a piece of brass that should not have ever been worshipped after it did its purpose. You know, God is always doing a new thing. Don't get hung up on old stuff. See, I'm from the old school, and I still use a pencil and paper. And Kathy and I were talking yesterday, you know, because we're from, anybody still know what a pencil, do they still have pencil? I know they don't teach cursive in school. Y'all don't know what cursive is? It's a Japanese man in Hong Kong. That's what, and I don't know how you sign your name. I guess it's all electronic now, but we're living in a new day, and I have to get around young people that are smart, that walk around with that plastic glass thing in front of their face. Instead of having a relationship with me, they want to talk to, don't get mad, I'm just trying to show you. It's a new world. How many know it's a new world? So if we're going to broadcast, we can't broadcast now by writing letters to people and putting on stamps and doing that like we used to. Now we have to come to the place where we get a little digitization. Is that a good word? I make up one. Kathy and I and the Woodsons went to Tommy Barnett's School of Ministry about 15 years ago in Phoenix. And they were talking about how to get your mailing list appropriate, how to get all the financial records so that it's easy for the ministry. And Linda looked over at Kathy and she said, I guess they don't use 5x8 business cards, 3x5 index cards anymore. If you don't know what that is, people used to write their name on a card, and we had to stay up all night long writing out people's names and addresses on envelopes, putting on stamps. Y'all still here and having to alphabetize them and then zip code them, and my kids still hate the ministry today because they spent all their life having to lick. I'm just trying to help you right here. That will be in one of the chapters of the book. The one thing I hate about the ministry is having to lick and write and post and alphabetize when we could have had a computer. Would my children please forgive me now for making them work all day and all night on mailing lists? I'm saying that, but I want you to listen. We're living in a new age and a new time. Get rid of those things from your past that keep you from going into your future. Get rid of those things that limit you from where you are. Let me go on. The Bible said he trusted in the God of Israel. So after him, there was none like him among all the kings of Judah, nor any that were before him. What God is saying about Hezekiah, he was one of the most awesome men that ever lived, even to the estate of being like King David. He clave to the Lord. He did not depart from following him. He kept his commandments that the Lord had given all the way back to Moses. The Lord was with him, and he prospered everything that he put his hand to do. And he didn't rebel against God, but he rebelled against the king of Assyria that was trying to control and manipulate the people of God. He refused to serve the enemy. He smote the Philistines, and it gives all their accolades. The Bible says that in verse 11 that the king of the Assyrians, which is the enemy, carried away all the other Israelis unto Assyria. The reason for that was they would not obey God. They would not obey the voice of God, transgress the covenant. They refused to hear God, and they refused to do what God asked them to do. How many of you are recognizing that we're living in an hour where people don't want to do anything they don't want to do? Anybody know that right now people want to have their own way? Don't tell me what to do. You don't have a right to tell me what to do. Don't preach to me. Don't tell me. Well, yeah, you do have to listen because I'm just telling you what God said. You don't have to listen to me, but he's got something to say that's going to bless you. And if you're going to be blessed, you need to listen to somebody that cares about you. Am I right about it? And so what he is saying in the 14th year, verse 13 of Hezekiah, that Sennacherib, which is the king of Assyria, came against all the cities of Judah and he took them. So Hezekiah said, well, maybe I've offended him, so I'll give him an offering. How many know you can't appease the enemy? He later came back and said, I won't kill you and I won't destroy you if you'll just give me an offering. I just got to tell you, my sacrifice has already been paid. I'm not going to give the enemy anything. As a matter of fact, it may make you a little upset, but we've been arguing with the devil long enough. Matter of fact, can I give you a new theory? Stop praying against the devil. Oh, devil, you got to get out of my way. Oh, devil, stop it. Tell God what you need. The devil's defeated. If he's not defeated, you can't defeat him. If Jesus didn't do it, you can't. He did it. Everybody say, he paid it all. Don't be talking about devil. You got no. You let God deal with him. You serve God and you praise God. You worship God. The devil is a defeated liar, and every time he's talking, he's lying to you. Amen. Well, the devil told me. I don't care what the devil told you. You ought to shout about it, because the opposite's going to happen unless you buy into the lie. Believe the truth, you have what God said. Anybody ever have the devil try to talk you out of stuff? And he's real convincing because he makes it sound almost right. He's a liar. Anybody have any friends that when they open their mouth, never mind. I was saying the other day, I have a friend that when he calls, says, I'm going to come by in about an hour and visit, I don't even put on coffee. Because when his lips are moving, he's lying. Help me. I mean, after a while, we lose confidence. Come on, say amen. 19, I'm going to give you this. So Reb Shechel, which is the ambassador for the king, coming to the man of God, the king Hezekiah, he said, I want you to speak this word. Thus saith the great king of Assyria, what confidence is this that you have? You're telling me about you have counsel and might for war. You don't have any power to rebel against me. I just want to say something to you. I don't have to have power and authority other than the authority of God. How many physically, don't look at me like this, but how many understand I can't take on everybody in this room? Amen. I could probably whip the baby and I could whip a few that are littler than I am, but I'm not going to promise that I can take on some of the bigger guys in the house. How many understand I understand my limitation? But the king is telling, the enemy king is telling Hezekiah, God's king, he says, don't even think about counseling and how you've got all this might in your hand because you don't have any authority against me. What he is saying is in one way very valid, and this is where it really becomes hard for us to separate from what God is going to do and what the enemy said. He's talking in the language of his people at first, and then he begins to speak in the language of the Jews. And he said, I want you to hear the word of the great king. Wouldn't it be amazing if all of us started bragging about our God the way the devil brags about his kingship? This is what he said. Do not let Hezekiah deceive you, people. He shall not be able to deliver you out of his hand. Neither shall Hezekiah, you shall let him make you trust in the Lord, saying that the Lord will deliver us and the city shall not be delivered in the hand of Assyria. What he is saying is, I don't want you to believe what God is saying. I don't want you to believe your king that's telling you how great your God is. I just got to tell you, I have one thing to tell you, and that is that God has the power over every threat in your life, and there are going to be, please don't get mad, 2016, you are going to experience more threats, different threats against your body, against your family, against your finance, against your future than you've ever had in your life. The enemy sees his day coming, but I got to tell you, I know I'm in a kingdom where there is no failure. I'm not going to allow the enemy to come on and do any more against me, because I don't have to put up with his mess. First of all, I'm not going to believe his lie. So the devil is saying, don't believe God. Why would he even say that? I think he's to talk you out of believing God. Wasn't that brilliant? Why? Because if you believe God, the enemy's defeated. If you believe the liar, you have what the liar says. Aren't you glad you're believing the right thing? Verse 31, don't listen to Hezekiah. Just make an agreement. Bring me a present, and then I'll let you eat, and I'll let everybody have their own land and until I come and take you away. We're living in a time where we're facing a lot of valid threats against our country, against our person, against our family. How many know there's a lot of threats out there? So we have to make up our mind. Are we going to walk around scared to death all the time and turn off the TV and hide in a closet? Or are we going to praise God in the open and magnify the God that knows how to take care of his kids? If I don't say anything else today, I want you to hear me here and those by broadcasting. You don't have anything to fear if you're obedient to God. Ever. But they tell me we're going to starve to death. Not me. Amen. God fed about 3 million people 40 years in a desert with no Walmart, no Golden Corral, no Bob Boy, big, help me, not even any White Castle. He fed them for 40 years out of the heavens. I don't care what takes place. He is going to take care of me, and I'm going to have greasy lips, whatever we have to go through. So if you want to eat, hang around me. Come on, say amen. Well, did you brag it? And mighty right. I got a great big God that takes care of his kids. I know about your father. My father loves me a lot. He said, I'm going to take you away, and I'm going to take you to your own land, give you the land that flows with milk and honey. He's promising something like God promised, but only in captivity. He said, I'm going to give you a chance to live and not die. And then he's going to try to tell you that God wants to deliver you, but I don't want you to believe that. Look at verse 33. This is very critical. He said, have any of the gods of the nations delivered at all the land out of the hand of the king of Assyria? What about all those countries we've been to and all their idol gods like Hamath and Arphad and Sepharzim and Hena and Iva, have they delivered Samaria out of the hand, my hand? Who are they among all the gods of the countries that have delivered their country out of my hand, that the Lord should deliver Jerusalem out of my hand? What? Oh, this is very important. Have you ever had the enemy tell you what he's already done? Look at all I've already done in your family, your past. Everybody in your family's had cancer. Everybody in your family's had this. All the kids have had this addiction or that problem. And he tells you all that he's accomplished. Then he comes to you and said, I'm after you now. What he is saying is, you have no opportunity to do anything but bow down to me and take whatever I want to give you. And what I got to tell you is, no, no, no. You've gone as far as you can go. You're at the end of your leash. You're at the end of your rope. You've taken enough family members. You've taken enough of my joy and my peace. You've taken enough of my loved ones. You're not going to take anybody else. Enough is enough. I'm drawing a line to the sand. How many of you recognize we either draw the line to the sand and make the enemy stop where he is, or we let him in and have total control? No, say it. I'm not going to let him have anything else. Now get this, because it's very important. He is already reminding them of what he's already done. He talks about all the past accomplishments and all that he's already done. And the Bible said when he came and brought this word to the king, all of the messengers started ripping off their garments out of terror and fear and out of humbleness before the Lord. And the Bible said God had spoken to the king and said, when the enemy talks, don't answer him. Why? Because the Lord already gave you the answer. Don't make up your own. Would somebody say these words with me? It is written. You don't have to have an answer. It's already written. You don't have to know any other answer. You know the one that is the answer. Don't argue with the devil. Just go back. Jesus, when the enemy came against him, he said, it's already written. I don't have to say anything else. It is already written. With his stripes, I'm healed. I'm healed. Family salvation, because that's for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. It's already written. But you don't know what the temptation is with our kids from elementary school up. It is already written. God is going to give me back what the enemy has destroyed. He is going to restore my life and my health and my future. This is not going to be a year of defeat. It's going to be a year of threats. Threats that the enemy cannot fulfill. Say it out loud. Invalid threats. Cannot fulfill. Will not be accomplished, because I am in a kingdom with a God that knows how to make heaven and earth and take good care of his children. Would somebody say, deliverance is on the way? How many of you have established that you're not going to pray against the devil a whole lot more anymore? Chapter 19, when Hezekiah heard the word, he ripped off his clothes and covered himself with humble sackcloth. He went to the house of the Lord. I know this will sound like preacher talk, but the next time you get a major threat, I don't want you to run off scared and hide in a cave. Get to church. Come into the presence of God's people. Who do you think you are? We're the body of Christ. That's who we are. We have the presence of God. We can change the world. There's no other hope for the world outside the body of Christ. Come on, say amen. This is not church building. This is kingdom building. The Bible said he went to the house of the Lord, and then he sent his ambassador to the prophet. Dear God, we need some prophets. Heard somebody say last year, there are no more prophets. I don't know what kingdom they're in. Well, I heard somebody prophesy a lie. Yeah, but that didn't have anything to do with God. I mean, God still has a word. I've heard some of our young people prophesy around here and didn't even realize they're doing it. I mean, it's not about some hero with a big old badge says, I'm prophet. Run from those people. Amen. Am I right? The reason we don't believe in real prophets is because we've got too many people charging us $65 every month to get our family saved. That is of the devil. Come on, offering God something, you know, having to pay God for something he already paid for, that is not God. That's idolatry. Either we're serving the Lamb that died for us and paid it all, or we're not. Well, why do you take offerings? So we can tell people about Jesus. Amen. Matter of fact, I'm getting ready to take an offering today so we can tell some people about Jesus. As soon as we got the call, we want you to spend thousands of dollars this next year on telling a whole lot of people all over this part of the country, three states, about Jesus. I said, yeah, absolutely. Let's figure out when we get started. Why? Because if you have an opportunity, work while it's day. Do as much as you can. How many are willing to help us do that? Because when you close your eyes, I got ushers that are going to come down the aisle and get your pocketbook and your wallet and write out. It's all kinds of stuff. It's going to be fun. Just playing. Let me come to a closing. The prophet of God said, this is what Hezekiah said to the prophet. This is a day of trouble, and it's a day of rebuke. It's a day of blasphemy. Because the children of God have come to the place of being born, of birthing. There's no strength to bring forth. It's hard when you're ready to have your baby, but you don't have the strength to have your baby. In other words, God is getting ready to birth something, 2016, and I pray we as the church have the strength to bring it forth. Can you imagine a woman that she can't have her child? Bone structure won't allow it, or because of some physical weakness, she doesn't have the strength to push. It's ready. That's how close we are to birthing what God is promising. I've got a word I'm going to send out for the body of Christ. It's just we put out a scroll for people to hold on to the promise for the year. And listen very closely. As I was writing it, this is what the Lord spoke to my spirit. He said, tell my children that this nation and this world is in a birthing pain. How many believe we're getting ready to bring forth what God planned before the foundation of the world? I said, well, I had a baby. It was an 11-month baby. No, you didn't. You just miscounted. How many know when that baby's coming? Honey, it's coming. Am I right? It will come right on time. Am I right? What God has promised you is going to come right on time. Say it with me, right on time. Isaiah said, thus shall you say to the master, thus saith the Lord. How many know that God still knows how to talk? Oh, I wish I could amplify this. Even when I wrote it down, I highlighted it in red. Be not afraid of the word that you've heard. Come on, look over at your neighbor and tell him, don't be afraid of what you heard. Having no words can scare the life out of you. Am I right? God said, tell my people and tell the king, Don't be afraid of what he just heard. The enemy just said, I've conquered every other king in Israel. I've taken all of God's people slaves and hostage, and now I'm coming to your door. And God said, don't be afraid of what you've heard. Why? Because God is not dead. God is not weak. Men got into trouble and they're slaves because they refused to obey God. If you walk in obedience, you have everything that God planned and everything that God purposed. Let me settle the score and say a hard thing. Israel has always been protected when they allowed God to be their God. When they wanted Babylon, they wanted Baal. God said, go after Baal. Let him throw your kids in the fire to Ashtaroth and all the other gods. And when you wake up and come back to me, return to me and I'll return to you. If you want God, obey God. That's as simple as it is. If you don't want him, he won't force himself on you. I got to say this. We're returning to God and we're getting back into covenant, and God is going to do greater things than the world has ever seen. I am thankful because I know it's true. I'm not trying to brag or act old on you right now, because sometimes I feel old, but as I close this year, 2015, I will end up December 25th celebrating 50 years in the ministry. Symbolically, 50 means Jubilee. If you don't know what Jubilee is, go back to the Old Covenant. It's when in the year of Jubilee, after seven Sabbaths of years, 49 years, God brought his people to a place of Jubilee. They got their children back out of prison. Everybody that was in jail, everybody that was sick, all the land they had sold in times of poverty, they got their contracts, they got their land deeds back, they got their blessings back. Everything was restored in the year of Jubilee. Somebody said, well, when is the year of Jubilee? Oh, we had it a few years ago, and everybody got excited. And somebody said, well, it's this year again. Honey, when you're in the new covenant, you don't have to wait 50 years to get saved. Every year is a Jubilee when you begin to apply yourself to the Word of God and the will of God. Say it, Jubilee cometh. In the Oklahoma vernacular, it's heareth. Anybody ready to believe that it's not just coming, but it's already here? Anybody want your family back and your health back and your joy back? How many like to see and hear and feel? And... Amen. Well, I don't know if I want to hear. Well, there's sometimes I wish I couldn't hear. It's clear, but that's okay. How many ready to get back what the enemy's taken? I'm supposing everybody has a family member the enemy has taken. Are you going to get them back? Come on, say it one more time. Don't be afraid of what you heard. Notice how God fights this battle. He says, I'm going to send a blast upon him. I'm going to send wind. And the way I'm going to do this is I'm going to cause him to hear a rumor. Anybody hear a rumor? Anybody ever hear? It can change your life when you hear a rumor. It changed Sennacherib's life when he heard a rumor. You know, sometimes we think God has to send lightning bolts for heaven. Sometimes God has to just change the atmosphere. He said, oh, about that guy that's threatening you outside the camp, he's going to return to his own land. He's going to die at his own house. This year, God's going to fight some of your battles in ways you're not expecting it, and you might almost miss it. You'll look back and say, wow, what happened? I didn't expect that. See, God makes a way where there never was a way like that before. How many know God hasn't run out of ideas? Anybody believe that God is awesome? You know, sometimes I tell him, God, you're real smart. Somebody said, that's stupid. No, but I know a lot of people that don't think he's smart. Say it. See how good that feels in your mouth. Say it. You're smart. So the Bible says, so Rebekah, he returned and found the king of Assyria warring against Libna, and he heard a word. He heard the rumor. Sent back to Hezekiah, and he said, thus shall you speak to Hezekiah. Let not thy God in whom you trust deceive you. Can I just tell you right now? Your God cannot deceive you. So when he got the letter, Hezekiah went to the house of the Lord and he laid the letter before the Lord. He said, Lord, this is your battle. I can't fight this. Did you know the enemy was already outside the city? Thousands and thousands of people. The Israelites couldn't even go outside the gate of the city. They couldn't go out and get water. They couldn't go plant their fields. They couldn't harvest. They were captivated. And so when Isaiah, the king, the prophet of God, the man of God, if you will, call him all of those things because they're, I believe, appropriate. Verse 19 says, O Lord our God, I beseech you, save us out of the hand of the enemy and all of your kingdoms of the earth. They will know that you're really the only Lord, even you're the only one. What he is saying is, this is really not about all of us. I want you to be glorified in this. I'll benefit, but you're going to be glorified. Isaiah sent a message back and said, thus saith the Lord of Israel, that which you have prayed unto me against Sennacherib, the king of Assyria, I've heard you. I'm going to establish something right now because I've got a little quiet moment right here. Whatever you've been praying to God, listen, He heard you. Well, why doesn't He hurry? He's not in a hurry. Somebody shared with me last night, it was an awesome, blessed word, and it said, God deals with us in time because He's not limited by that. We are. It's for our benefit. He has all time. We don't. But He gives us His. How many know God loves to delay stuff? He's not in a hurry. Why is He not in a hurry? Because He already knows what He's going to do. Amen. We're in a hurry because we don't think He's going to remember. Right. Come on, say it. God does not have Alzheimer's. No, amen. Move on. He says to the king of the enemy, verse 28, you need to mark this. Very important. We're going to just give a couple of verses and leave. Because of your rage against me and the tumult which has come up into my ears, I will put a hook in your nose and a bridle in your lips. I'll turn you back the way you came. In other words, you're not going any further. I'm going to put a hook in your nose. Anybody ever get a hook in your nose? Anybody? My uncle went fishing and he was casting and something happened and he got the hook right in his nose. Oh. I wasn't even there and it hurt me. Anybody ever get something in your nose? I know people now got the big old things. Lord, I don't know how they do that. That's just... But I promise you, if they got that ring in their nose and you walk up, if they are a 400-pound bull and got all the muscles rippling and all they do is live at the gym and eat health food, grab that bully thing by their nose and pull. They'll follow you. If you say bow, they're going to bow. Amen. Okay. I was going to get carnal and say, oh, for you men that your wife has got a hook in. Yeah, let's just move right along. We're just trying to help you out. But how do you know that? Okay. Look at verse 32. This is what God is saying to me, and I believe He's saying this to you. Therefore, somebody say, well, therefore, saith the Lord concerning your enemy, the king of Assyria, he shall not come into this city. I thought three or four people would be running around the building going, whoo, hallelujah, but I guess I have to explain that. Look at me. The king of Israel heard God say, the enemy's not coming in. In other words, he's out there, but he's not coming in. Oh, but he threatens he's going to take my kids, and he threatens he's going to take my companion. He threatens my family. No, he's not going to get through the door. Anybody believe that God knows how to keep the door closed against the enemy? See, if you're, oh God, God said Hezekiah was in obedience to God. He was faithful to God. And once you have a covenant with God and you, my brother, you haven't been faithful, start now. Amen. And did you know if you'll start right now in about 15 minutes, you can say, I've been faithful for 15 minutes already. And God will say, yes, you have been faithful, and I have to honor your faithfulness. Am I right? I don't know how much longer than 15 minutes I can hold out. If you can do 15, you can do 30. I'll send somebody with you to watch you, to affirm you and encourage you, can make it for an hour. Amen. Let's go to White Castle, then you're doomed. Let's go on. Trying to help you. I want to hear you say this out loud. He will not come into this city. You know what that means? He's gone as far as he can. Oh, God. He's gone as far as he can go. I made a statement this week, and I'm going to make it again. We have a word we used to say when I was, you know, in another part of the country where we didn't use all of our proper grammar. And we would simply say this to the devil, Clody Doe. Okay. Close the door. If the enemy's getting into your house, you're the one that left the door open. Close the door. If the door's open, he's invited to come in. If the door's closed, he can't come in. Say it, clo-de-do. I know that's not good vernacular, but that helps some folks that don't understand the proper King's English. Say it again, close the door. I remember as a child, we lived in Visalia, California, where Brother Robert Hooks is from. Hello, Pastor. And what I want you to hear, my mother didn't know that we were poor, so she had those locks that you slide, the kind you twist, the kind you turn, all of them. She had the skeleton key. Anybody remember skeleton key? I don't know who invented that, but that was dumber than dirt. They went to all the trouble putting a skeleton lock, and then you could buy a skeleton key that would fit anybody's house for a dime at the hardware store. Duh. That's like leaving the door open. I don't know why the devil's getting in my house all the time, because you got a pile of skeleton keys outside in a bowl waiting for him to come. Help me. Say it again. Close the door. I'm going to affirm to you right now as we begin this year, if you will keep the door closed, the enemy's done all he can do. He can't come in to take anything else. He can't destroy anything else because he can't do it from the outside. And you're not going to let him come back on the inside. Can I get one person to say, the door's closed and the lock is God's word, his provision, his promise, and he's taken all he can take. And now I'm sending out ambassadors because God said, when you find out who the thief is, the thief himself has to bring back sevenfold everything he's stolen. So this is going to be a mighty good year. God is going to restore everything you've lost. And Lord, I love it. I've lost a lot, so I'm going to gain sevenfold. I shouldn't tell you my secrets, but I'm starting to leave stuff out that I want multiplied so the devil can steal it and have to bring back seven. It'll just help you. And if I do that seven times, I'll be ready for Jubilee. Multiplication, 749. Okay, how many are ready for God to restore everything? God didn't say he was going to restore what was stolen. He said the devil's going to bring it back. Who stole your kids and family and loved ones? Who's going to deliver them to you? Some of you getting ready to have the bar keep coming and bring somebody to your house. Say, you can't handle this one anymore. Y'all been praying for this one. You got to take it. Okay. Drug dealer going to come over there, wipe the powder out of their nose and say, hey, I got all these kids here. You can't let them come out here anymore. You've been praying for them. They're coming home, all seven of them. I lost three people right there. But so do you really believe that with all my heart? God is going to give you back. Say it. He's going to give you back. If God ever uses anything he takes from you for his glory, he repays you 100-fold. Wow, I don't know if I got a big enough house to contain 100-fold. Don't let that pass you by. Let's close. The door is closed. The enemy cannot come in unless I make a choice to let him. And you're going to get back what you've lost. Can I just say to people that have been hurt and wounded in church, it's time to get healed. Yes. Somebody asked us a while ago, have you ever been offended? Yes. Have you ever offended folks? Yes. I raised my hand after. I didn't know what the other one was. I knew I probably was guilty. How many have ever been guilty? Yes. Say it. I can get offended. But I don't ever have a right to quit. No. Well, I used to go to that church, but I quit. You don't have a right to quit. No. You can quit people, but you can't quit God. Right. I know people can become jerks and hurt you. God doesn't jerk. I mean, he only does you good. Amen. Anybody ready to stop blaming offense? I know some powerful, powerful orators and Bible scholars are sitting home mad because they got hurt in church. They should have known that that shouldn't offend me enough to keep me away from God or stop my gifting. See, the enemy knows what it is that will make you quit. Because you let him in the door. Whew. It's been really nice being a part of you for 30 years here in Washington Courthouse, and whoever you hire to preach next week, I pray God's blessing upon their life. Everybody say, the truth will make you free. Amen. God said he shall not come into this city. He's not even going to shoot an arrow over the wall in here. He's not going to come and gather around it any longer. By the way he came is the same way he's going to go. He's not going to come into this city, saith the Lord. Anybody believe that? Well, yeah, but he already, no. He's doing what he did because we opened up. He's gone as far as he's gone because we opened our house. I mean, when he comes in the house, he just didn't come inside the door and stop. He gets into every room. He affects every child, every companion, every friend. I mean, hear what I'm saying. Is this helping anybody? This is the time that God is saying, go into this year with the door closed against the enemy and the heavens open toward God. Amen. Anybody believe that God's going to do phenomenal things this year? He's already started verifying and proving as the praise. Dear God, I don't know what you think happened this morning, but the praise team didn't just sing a song to you. They were telling God how great he is. They were worshiping a mighty God that is fixing their body, their family, their future. And that's what real praise is about. It's not about people just being real good. And honey, these have got the most awesome harmony. They sing the most awesome song. Help me. But if the Spirit of God was not upon it, it would do nothing but tickle our ears. But today God got down into the depths of somebody's spirit and set you free. Am I right? I'm over there trying to get my composure so I can preach. I would like to have the presence of God so strong you couldn't even talk. God said, I'm going to defend this city and save it for my own sake and for my servant David's sake. Some of you don't realize that God is working in your behalf, not just because of your faithless mama, but because you had a mom and a daddy. They have a covenant. That covenant's still valid, even though they're dead, and it's still going to work. Their grandkids are going to know. Third and fourth generation, they're still going to come back. Why? Because the covenant of God is not broken. David is already dead and gone for decades and years, but now a new king came, and God said, hey, Hezekiah, I'm going to do this not just for you because you're righteous. I'm going to do this because David made a covenant. David made a contract. I made an agreement with David, and I've got to bless everybody that comes out of his loins and a part of his covenant. Some of you need to realize that God's going to set everybody that you can commit into his hands absolutely free. Last verse. Came to pass that night that the angel of the Lord went out and smote the camp of the Assyrians. 185,000. They rose in the next morning, and they fell, looked outside, and they were all dead corpses. 185,000 people, one angel killed in one evening. You know what? I don't see that the enemy has much power when all the armies of the enemy gather together and one angel in one evening wipes out everybody. They got piles of people laying out there bragging about how strong they are and what they're going to do. They were the threat. The threat's dead. The threat can't come in to kill. I want you to bow your head. The Spirit is saying right now, the threat in this room is broken if you give it to God. Father, we praise you because many times in scriptures it was spoken by your servants, the battle is not mine. Father, the battle that somebody's fighting today, they just heard the doctor say, there's no power for them to conquer the cancer. The doctor can't even do that. So why say it's my battle when there's nothing anybody can do at this point? But if the battle's the Lord's, he knows how to eradicate the cancer to the root, so that it doesn't even pass on to another generation. There are those in this room who are threatened in their marriage. There's those in this room that are threatened on their job. There's some, the relationship with brothers and sisters and family, mamas and daddies are broken. There's a threat for a horrible future coming. But you sent me to this people to tell them, keep the door closed this year. The enemy's done all he can do, and God is going to make him restore every place he's messed with my people. I receive that word right now. The thread is being broken. The power of the deliverer is working in this room. Thank you, Lord. The Father said phase two is beginning right now, the promise of the manifestation. Not only because you've laid upon the altar that which is your petition, but also because I've chosen you to be my authority among a people that nobody but you can touch. I poured the oil upon your hands and upon your lips and in your heart. I've anointed your feet. Your eyes will behold my glory and your lips will speak my word. You will lock the door of the house of those that do not have the wisdom to lock it for themselves. I will be the protector and I will be the restorer. Horrible feeling, the lonely feeling, walking alone at times, though you're in a crowd, no one seems to understand and nobody's really with me. The Lord is the shade upon your right hand. That means he's shadowing everything you reach out to him. He's a very present hand. So the tears are going to dry, and before you leave this room, they won't be salty and sour, they'll be sweet. Tears of concern become tears of thanksgiving. I release you for what God has laid upon your hands and your heart, and you will fulfill it far greater than what you've even imagined and been told. In the name of Jesus. So this battle, this struggle is not yours, it's the Lord's. The victory has begun in its establishment phase. There's some process going on today. I didn't mean to pick on you, my friend, but I want to tell you, I saw the Lord putting like hooks down inside the depth of your soul and your spirit, and I saw him pulling out things that you could not let go of. And he's pouring in for the ashes of beautiful blessings and peace and restoration. Idle words, condemning words, accusations, hurts that are invalid are not going to harm anyone. But I ask God to warm your blood, your organs, your bones, your senses. And I release you to what God has promised to you. It's not happen chance that you've passed by for the associations and the relationships and even being in this room today. We just get to be a little bitty part of encouraging and strengthening what God's doing in your life, what He already has planned. Thank you, Father, for victory. I thank you, Father, because my sister needs a confirmation, a reaffirmation. In your kingdom, nothing is missing and nothing is broken. Things are not always the way they seem. But again, you say you're going to make up for the years that the caterpillar, palm worm, and canker worm have devoured. Restore them. Fight for her what you can't fight for her anymore. Today. Because the enemy has shot his last arrow across the wall into her city. He's not coming in again. In Jesus' name. And everybody in agreement say, beginning today, the provider releases provision. Manifestation comes to fulfillment. I know time is passing, but I want everyone to point your hand toward me here and far. I want you to say this with me. I believe what I've heard from God. I allowed the enemy through my door. Today I close the door against all the effects of the enemy in every area of my life. And from loved ones and everyone that's under my authority, under my prayer cover. I will not fear anymore, but I will praise God. I will not argue with the liar, but I'll praise the truth giver. Beginning today, I choose to live in the fulfilled covenant. I say to your body, be healed. I say to your physical, emotional, be restored. For those of you that declared today, I need the Lord in my life, we've already settled that if you call upon His name, you shall be saved. Doesn't mean you're perfect. It means you're on your journey. He'll walk with you every step of the way. Thank you, Father. I feel like we needed just a moment of peace, a moment of praise. I want everybody to keep your eyes closed. Just point your hand toward me. Father, I thank you today that you're doing some things, and there's an illustrated sermon going on with me and Ann right now. There's times I felt like a motherless child. Father was taken and I needed him. I felt like an orphan. No place to run, no one to turn to for counsel. Beginning today, Ann, God is going to be mother and father, sister and brother and friend. He's going to bring to you those that really understand and care. They're only looking at one thing, a hurting heart, a hand that needs someone to grab it, someone to embrace her, strengthen her. God, make up for the years she's had to suffer alone. Rebuke every devour, Father, in Jesus' name. Peace we speak. Perfect peace, new beginnings. In Jesus' name. I want you to look up at me a minute. I know this is not always an easy thing, but will you say this so we can all hear it? I will never throw anybody else away. Everybody has equal importance to my Father, and they're supposed to have equal importance to me. Doesn't mean the relationships are all exact because we're on different levels. Never has anyone done so much or been so far away that God doesn't want His kids back. Am I right? How many of you glad people didn't give up on you when you kept falling? I'm supposing you fell. And if you didn't raise your hand, I'm going to ask God to reveal it so we can embarrass you real good. How many of you understand this year people are going to come in with all kinds of problems? The other night someone came to me and said, Pastor, you remember when you warned us in the service that we got to get ready because people are going to come in and they're going to have all kinds of problems and all kinds of needs, all kinds of bondages, sickness, perversions. Love them. They're going to come in with spiked hair looking like roosters. with wires through both jaws and so high they don't know where they are. Hug them when they sit with you. Love them. Come on, somebody help me. Just because people's culture is a little different, how many understand? We are the body of Christ, and our job is not to point ugly fingers. Our job is to heal and restore every person that comes, allowing us to be a part of their life. Daddy used to say, when you're pointing one finger that way, you got three fingers and a thumb pointing right back at you. So you need to sweep around your own door. Can I get an amen? Did anybody hear the word this morning? Anybody going to go home and get a new lock for your door? How many of you will not go buy Ace Hardware and get a skeleton lock and a skeleton key? And then send one over to the devil so he can get in whenever he wants to? How many of you believe that this is God's timing and his word today? Come on, let's clap our hands and praise him for the protection that comes from the provision of the Lord, the power of his promise, his word. I just got to tell you, if God can heal, can deliver people from 185,000, I don't think I've got that many enemies. If you know something I don't know, tell me. But I don't think any of us, all of us put together, don't have that many attacks. If God can do that because he promised, how many, he's just saying that so he can do it for us in our generation, bring blessings and add increase. So expect this year to be a year where we don't have to bow to the threat. Come on, say it again. No more valid threats. Because I'm not even a part of that kingdom anymore. I'm under a covenant, and God takes care of his kids. I feel good now. It was what you're feeling before. I had to share this because it's not easy, because sometimes folks want to keep the door open. Come on. Somebody said, when God closes one door, he leaves a window open. Well, that's probably true, but how many, if you got one door closed and when you close that door, a window opens, you probably got something going on in your house. Amen. You need to make sure you lock the door and lock the windows. You need to make sure that God is the one that opens the door and God closes the doors. And I'm very thankful that he does those things. I'm very thankful for his favor this morning. I want to thank you for your love. I feel in this room that there's a divine connection between us. You know, there's times that you minister. Last week it was like I was having to grind my teeth and have to eat bear meat to get the word of God out. And I realized why. It's because when it's desperately needed, the enemy tries to bring every distraction that he can. How many understand? He can try to distract all he wants. The word of God goes through and it meets the place where it meets and meets the mark and brings victory. And I just want you to hold on to this word like you never had before. How many appreciate all the camera crew and the television crew, those behind stage? Let's let them know we appreciate them so very much for their efforts. I appreciate them so very much. I want you to bow your head for a moment. We're going to receive just a quick offering. We rarely take time in the service to make mention of those things. But beginning this year on the New Year's Eve service, we shared just briefly a bit of the vision, even though it was just now beginning to unfold. I don't want anyone looking around, but I have 25 envelopes that are marked. They're not even marked, but they are earmarked for what we're preparing to do. This week, I'll be getting a contract from Texas for TBN programming, already from the tri-state area, Indiana, Ohio, and Kentucky, out of Richmond. And also, we're expecting to get a report back from Lewis Center TBN, a Columbus market. And the radio programming, we're talking, finding out exactly the dates to start. It'll be in, Kathy and I listened to WGNZ on the way into the service just to make sure the signal goes all the way to Columbus. And it's a powerful station. Dear friends, it's been a lot of work. I appreciate them a lot. And they've offered us a time slot early as people are driving to church in the early morning Sunday from 10 to 10:30. And this will be for our young adults, for the Rooted Body of Ministry. It's going to really have an impact on young adults. They're going to give testimonies, they're going to give insights and songs, and it's going to be a special time. But while your head is bowed, I'm going to ask you to do it, and I'm not asking you to do it today. One or two have already come back, and one of our sisters, I'm going to have her just to receive a blessing for helping to start the charge this morning. I'm asking for everyone in the room to give $50. Somebody says, well, I don't have it. Well, I think in a period of time you will. If you have to set aside a dollar a week till 50 weeks has gone by, if you had to do it that extreme slow, I'm just asking, we need your strength. We're going to sign the contract this week. It'll be back in the mail, and I need the resources to do it. Somebody says, well, I don't know why you need money, because we want to get the gospel out. What if we don't do that? Well, there's people we will not touch that we could touch. It's simply a choice to minister, and I can do this. I want you to help me, and together we'll put all of our efforts in. April's going to have a lot more work on her hands. The ministry team, the Rooted classes are going to have some special time, a lot of extra effort. We're going to touch potentially millions of people that we haven't touched yet. $50 is just an earmark, and I'm going to ask you to join with me in Jubilee. I'm a part of this, and I believe that God can open up great new financial doors. That's not even the issue. Are you willing to let God? If you've given in the past, I need you to strengthen our hands. And I believe that with all my heart, we're going to see the benefits in some of your own families. You're going to reap what we've sown for other families. We don't even know. But I'm going to take a moment. I'm going to walk the aisle. If you can play just some music, Danielle, for a moment, I want to just put this in your hand. I'm going to ask you to hold it, and then the giving services a time at the closing of next week, following weeks, as you have this. We're just going to mark it. We're going to show the world that God blesses soul winning efforts. We've got a lot of opportunities. We've got a lot to do. We've got a lot of equipment to buy. We've got a lot of things we have to do right now for the opportunities to be fulfilled. But lift up your hand if you will, and I'm going to come by. Just take this moment, and I promise you that God has already made preparations. He knows how to cause increase.